Welcome back to Sister Circle Live. Our next guest made major moves on the football field with the Clemson Tigers before achieving his dream of NFL stardom. But just after 5 months in the league, an injury sent him to the sidelines.
But he wouldn't stop there or wouldn't stay there for long and ultimately worked his way back to good health and signed on to play professional football in Europe. And more than the game, he's making his mark in the finance world. Please welcome Darius Robinson.
Yay!
And Darius. How you doing? I'm blessed. How you doing? Oh, you blessed. So are we, brother. Yeah. Nice to meet you.
All right.
Nice to meet you, sir.
Come on
in, friend.
You look nice.
Thank you kindly. We appreciate that.
Absolutely.
All right.
Yes.
You're just an all-around athlete, huh?
I try my best.
Yes. You were a three-sport athlete.
Yes.
Why did you choose football?
First, I wanted to say my mom loves the show.
Oh, thanks, Mom.
Hey,
she
Mommy.
Loves the show, and she DVRs all of it.
Yes.
So I want to say thank you for having me.
Oh, yes.
But to answer your question, football was ultimately the sport that I was best at. You know, playing basketball, I stopped growing a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
But I was always fast, and I had a gift for football. And, you know, it was just one of those sports that's tough, and it kind of represented me well, so it was kind of the sport that I took on.
Right, right. And while you were at Clemson in 2013, you played an integral role in the O'Bannon case, pay for play, and now this is all coming up now. It's coming to fruition. What are your thoughts on where this is moving with the NCAA and making sure our athletes are taken care of? Because anything can happen. Yes. Look what happened to Tua.
Absolutely.
You know?
Well, for me, it's a very, very personal topic because I actually went through a lot of things at college when I started my first business.
Yeah.
Where the NCAA rules stated that you cannot run your own business because you can't promote it because your likeness is basically owned by your university.
Wow.
So for me, it wasn't even about paying athletes originally. It was just about not taking food off the table for me and my family.
Right.
So when I started my first business, I was constantly in a compliance office. I'm constantly going through stuff just for owning my own business. So it even got to a point where it was like, okay, I'm gonna run my business without promoting my business.
Yeah.
But it was also a rule that backed that up saying that a student athlete can't make money for things that they're not actually earning themselves.
What?
So the rules just basically contradicted itself. So later on, NCPA that represented the players actually sent the email out to all football players and women's and men's basketball players talking about the case because Oscar Robinson and Ed O'Bannon from the past had already been fighting for rights for the EA Sports video game because the NCAA was making money off of their name and likeness but not paying them.
Right, right.
So they went to court and the judge was like, we need some relevant people. And they sent out an email and it was five guys that said, yes, we'll represent. And I was the face of it because I had the highest profile.
Oh my goodness. So what do you think the challenges are moving forward with what is now playing out in the NCAA where they're going to see if they want to go ahead and pay these athletes?
Well, that's a tricky situation, just simply because you have guys on the team, for example, who may not contribute as much as others.
Mm-hmm.
So I understand that part. But for the players, I think it's more challenging because they have to, you know, first off, they're still kids. They're still kids, ultimately, 18, 19, 20, 21. As long as you're still in college and you're going through the system, everything has been done for you.
Yes.
So they're still kids, so they have to kind of understand what should they take on, what should they get involved with, who they should listen to. And for the universities and the NCAA, it's basically like, how are you gonna govern it at this point? So it's a lot of things, but I guess we'll see over time.
Yeah.
Well, you've played for the NFL and you've played pro ball both in the States and overseas. What's the biggest difference between the two?
Well, my NFL career was short because I had an injury, but I was involved with it enough to see the ins and outs of the business side of it.
Mm-hmm.
I think more so in Europe, it's more so for the love of the game. Opposed to the money, simply because we don't get paid as much as they do over here in the NFL because the sport isn't as big. And obviously the cultural differences. I think it's really amazing to be involved in different cultures, and traveling to Europe is one thing, but actually immersing yourself in the culture, waking up every single day, going to the supermarket and stuff like that, it's a totally different experience. And I think most people, if you haven't traveled to Europe, you should go. And if you do, at least stay for 30 days is what I always encourage people to do.
Right. Let's talk. Oh, I'm sorry.
I want to know if you spoke any other languages.
Dankeschön.
Okay. Ooh. All right.
Yeah.
Say Sister Circle and Dankeschön.
I'm getting there.
Oh, okay.
See, the thing is, I still play American sports.
Right.
So the coaches are American.
Right.
Okay.
Don't say you're speaking if you can't speak it.
I can say a little phrases, okay. But I'm not there yet.
You're getting there.
I'm getting there.
Well, let's talk a little bit about.
Put me on spot.
I know I did. Let's talk a little bit about Colin Kaepernick, of course. Okay. Everyone is talking about it. We've talked about it, I think, the first 3 days of the week here on Sister Circle. Your thoughts on how it all played out? Who won in this situation, in your opinion?
Ultimately, man, the NFL just has so much power and so much money. For them, it's just all about their bottom line. Mm-hmm. So for them, they may still be in a win-win situation because it's always going to be guys who still want to play in the NFL.
Right.
There's a lot of people who are oblivious to what's really going on, mm-hmm. or incompetent, and they really don't even really care about that. They still want that platform. They still want the fame. So for the NFL, it's still a win-win situation. But for Colin and for us, you know, as our people, it's great for us because now people are aware.
Yes.
People are aware, and I think that's what's most important, is that a lot of people are just not conscious of what's really going on.
Right.
And being an athlete, I've noticed from experience that people sometimes see an athlete as just it.
Right.
Like,
right.
You're an it.
Shut up and play ball.
Like, you're an it, mm-hmm. but they don't understand that that is a human, too.
Yes. You know,
and they have feelings. So
yeah.
I think the awareness is the most important thing.
Good job. Yes. Yeah.
Well, you're not just a professional on the field. You have a professional career in finance.
Yes.
So tell us about how you transitioned from being an athlete to that professional financier.
Well, in college, when I had my first injury, my junior season, is when I kind of woke up knowing that football may not take me to where I want to go ultimately in my life. So that's when I started to branch out into different businesses. And over time, I was doing direct marketing, I was doing e-commerce because my time was limited.
Yeah.
You know, I couldn't really do much, so I had to really work online and stuff like that. But moving forward from that experience, I started to realize that at times, you know, you kind of get burned out trying to sell products all the time and trying to show people that, you know, they can do it for themselves. You may see something in a person and they don't necessarily see it in themselves. And, you know, you get burned out trying to put the vision in people after a while. So I got involved in foreign exchange.
Yes.
The currency, just traveling internationally, I kind of had a good grasp on how it worked.
Yes.
So I just wanted to get into foreign exchange because I can become self-efficient. I don't need anyone else to make money. And for me, that was really important because I'm at a point in my life now where, yeah, I enjoy sales. I enjoy all the different endeavors. But being able to make money on my own without, you know, accumulating customers was... is really, really good
my
for me.
My God, that is fantastic. Yeah. Speaking of God, talk a little bit about your spiritual walk and how that fuels you in your everyday life.
Well, that's my foundation. That's my foundation, and that's what's got me to this point because that voice in the back of your head, it's always there.
It sure
it's
is.
It's always there. But sometimes we want to do what we want to do, mm-hmm. and we don't always listen to that voice.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm a big advocate right now on just ascending to your higher self, you know, appreciating your personal essence.
Yes.
And just going to the next level and, you know, not always operating in our low vibrational state,
uh-huh.
but just elevating higher so we can, you know,
come
vibrate on.
On
higher frequencies.
I love it. Come on, Abraham Hicks. Darius, we thank you so much for your time today.
Thank
we
you.
Appreciate what you've done. If you'd like to follow him, please do so on Instagram @drobceo. All right.